We will restart the committee meeting, and thank you for the witnesses for bearing with us. The Parliament experienced a sudden internet outage across the whole Parliament, which is an outrage, but no, it's not. We do understand the broadcast and have worked very hard to resolve this, and we're pleased to welcome you back. I understand that Maggie Simpson has had to leave the meeting as formally notified. I will now move on to Colin Smith, who has questions for the remaining panellists.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome back to the panel. Can I follow up on the points that Fiona was making? Obviously, the vast majority of freight is transported by road, and that's likely to continue. If you think about the example we've just been talking about, the transportation of goods from Scotland to Northern Ireland, there's no rail links to Cairn Ryan Ferryport at all, and no rail links from the south to the town of Stranraer, the nearest town, only a windy track from Glasgow. Now, we've heard that the idea of a fixed link between Scotland and Northern Ireland is rightly being buried in Beaufort's Dyke and Irish Sea, and the reality is no one ever complains about the ferries to Northern Ireland. The problem is the condition of the roads to get to those ferry ports in the first place, the A75 and A77. So my first question is really to Richard Ballantyne. How reasonable is it when it comes to transportation of goods from Scotland to Ireland? Is the option of rail freight, or do we just need to be realistic and accept that without improvements to the A75 and the A77, a key Scottish ferry port is going to continue to lose business to Heysham, to Fleetwood, to Liverpool, to Holyhead when it comes to transporting goods to Ireland?
Yes, I think it's an excellent question, and very well articulated and described. I would agree. I don't think that, although certain freight operators and indeed the ports may have a particular view in that part of Scotland, but I don't see that the rail freight is a particularly viable option there, not least because there is an absence of rail freight operations in Northern Ireland itself. So those goods are traditionally transported on lorries. Where you might have slight mode shift is driver accompanied versus unaccompanied freight. That's where the trailers are dropped or driven by the same driver, etc. So there's some one or two options there, but for the most part, you're absolutely right. The A75 and the A77 are two critical routes for Scotland and indeed, you know, Northern England. And we have just when Sir Peter Hendy's review of connectivity around the union, which you know, almost kind of stimulated this debate about having a fixed link. In our evidence to that inquiry, we did suggest that even if you had a fixed link, you'd still have to invest not huge sums, but substantial sums in both those roads we've identified and others, of course. And you know, why spend all that money on a fixed link if you've still got the existing hinterland connections?
Thanks very much for that. I think the figure you had in your report was £1 billion in the roads, and I will take that any day for improvements in the South West. I want to move on to an issue that is still very relevant, obviously, to trade between Scotland and Northern Ireland, particularly as the gateway to the Republic of Ireland, but it also has implications for trade with the rest of the EU, and that's possible customs changes from the 1st of January 2022. Now, obviously, some of the plans have been postponed until possibly the middle of next year, but others will go ahead. Can I ask the panel, how significant will the impact be and how ready is Scotland to manage these particular changes? And if in particular you have any specific comments on the unique challenges we have regarding trade between Scotland and Northern Ireland. And maybe I could put that question first of all to Robert Windsor, as I know the Association have published material on the issue of the customs changes from January 2022.
Right, the customs changes coming in on 1st of January are very significant. In effect, you are seeing the UK reimposing full customs controls on all goods coming from the European Union into the UK. And I'm dealing here with the UK as a whole. I don't want to separate Scotland out in this matter because it is a mainland issue, if you like. What you will see is the imposition of the GVMS system, For the road freight environment in particular, you will see the need for a full customs declaration. You will see the need for greater compliance with rules of origin, because those have been largely overlooked. You will also see the disappearance of the delayed declaration system, which will be replaced with a proper EIDR system. And you will see the requirements for SBS goods, which is foodstuffs and products of animal origin, for the IPAFS declaration, as we call it. It is basically a pre-notification of those goods coming into the UK before they're shipped. It is quite a lot of bureaucracy to go through. And as I said earlier in my evidence, my view and the association's view is these are more significant impact on the UK as a whole than you know, what we saw on the 1st of January this year. I have to be honest, the Northern Ireland situation is extremely complex. We've already had problems being caused by the import agents should not be using what we call CHIEF, which is the customs handling of import and export freight, and that is tied to the Northern Ireland Protocol. And we are seeing, and that's for imports to Northern Ireland, and it's been replaced with the Customs Declaration Service. And the Customs Declaration Service is a much more difficult system. Just to give you an idea, in a CHIEF entry, a full entry is about 55 data fields. We're moving to 88 on a CDS thing entry. So you see there's a lot more data required. Specific problems, Scotland, Northern Ireland. Well, it is actually the increased disruption that is stemming from the imposition of CDS at the moment. I'm afraid it is a technical subject, and you know, I'm afraid I've been doing this for 45 years, and even I can't get my head around it sometimes. You know, it is a very technical and complex issue. And as I said earlier, we've got a lot of bits of the jigsaw. Like, we know what GVMS is, and there are trader schemes where people can sign up to voluntarily use it to see how it works. We've seen it been working in transit because it's automated certain functions. But until we see that vast bulk of Ro-Ro freight moving between you know, the EU and UK mainland, we're not going to see what it is. What we have to emphasize is GVMS is really only for what I would call road freight, whether it's accompanied or unaccompanied, and it will predominantly be impacting our venture on the South Coast ports. For freight from Ro-Ro from Scotland to Northern Ireland, yes, they will still have to be. I mean, they're already using things like GVMS, and there are now customs declarations going into Northern Ireland. So, in a way, the impact, I venture, for you on the 1st of January is going to be less.
That's really interesting. Can I put, I suppose, the same question to Brian Hepburn at DVDS? And Robert's just said he's been working in this business for 45 years and he can't get round some of the challenges. So can I ask Brian, in your experience, are businesses like yours and others ready for these possible changes that come into play from January?
Well, we view the whole thing, we just a kind of exclamation of dismay, really, you know what I mean? But just with the changes. But we are getting as ready as we can be. In some ways, the no more postponing the declarations will be helpful for some items of general freight. We're hoping that it's not going to lead to bottlenecks at various ports. We've had bottlenecks at ports, just the paperwork, no match. And sometimes it's good enough to get it out of the EU, but it's not good enough to import it into the UK. So what ends up happening is it ends up lying at the port. And that happened to me just this week, actually. I was importing some boats to Holland. So we're trying to get as ready as we can, but it's more about getting our customers ready as well. We need to try and pass the suit and spread the kind of load. So we need to do, we're doing a kind of process education amongst everybody that we currently work with, a lot of them. And that we're saying about the South Coast ports not affecting us, but will affect us in a lot of ways for our exports, because we're fish primarily goes through those ports in the South England. It don't go through, because obviously there's no direct link really between Scotland and Europe. It has to go through England. So that's where we're shipping our fish, and that's all the fish. That's everything from all the Scottish sea farms, all Maui, all these big salmon producers, all coming out of Larkhall, all getting done. Either they're going air freight out of Heathrow or they're going across the channel. So we're needing to be ready to ensure that we don't incur any further delays on that route. So we're actively preparing, and we're hoping that we're going to be ready. We're just hoping it's going to be easy enough, basically.
And have you had any issues? I mean, even Northern Ireland is a domestic market, but for obvious reasons, there are problems. Have you experienced problems when it comes to simply transporting domestic products from Scotland to Northern Ireland?
Definitely. It's nearly worse than importing to the continent. It's funny that there's different, like actual barriers seem to be unevenly applied in reality. Like, you know, for example, like importing directly into Holland is harder than importing into France. Going into Ireland is harder than going into France. It shouldn't be. It should be the same, but there's just seems to be difficulties. I could get some proper examples and send them across to you all for later on, you know, if you like, so you can sort of see. But no, it's trying to get something into Ireland, Republic or Northern is bad. And it's just been grim. And that's across that route, Cairn Ryan. It's not the best, frankly, in reality.
Thanks very much for buying. I think those examples would be really helpful. I suppose finally, can I put that question to Kieran? I appreciate your research was focused on the impact of COVID. Sorry,
Mr. Smith. Unfortunately, Professor Fernandez has had to briefly leave the meeting. I hope he'll be able to return. But I understand that Richard Ballantyne was interested in coming in on this point, so I'll invite Mr. Ballantyne to come in.
Yes, to follow Brian and Robert's suggestions and comments there, it's quite an interesting case. We've had, of course, a lot of the controls enforced at European borders, and Robert's absolutely right about the sort of bureaucratic changes, so I won't repeat what he's saying there, but what I'll talk about is the sort of physical nature of some of these changes that are being phased in next year. And now, to start with, in quite a basic term, and notwithstanding what Brian said about a lot of the Scottish exports going through English ports, for example, and obviously in the reverse, a lot of commodities that are consumed in Scotland would have come through an English or a Welsh port, for example, somewhere else in the UK. But a lot of the unitised activities in Scotland is focused on containers. And apart from that, we don't, as we heard earlier, we don't have any roll-on, roll-off links. So the major challenges of facilitating border checks at Scottish ports is not perhaps as dramatic as it may be at some of the Ro-Ro ports in England that have been much publicised about holding trucks up for minutes or even hours to unpack and inspect goods. That said, Scottish ports still have to comply with new control regimes. Many of them are building infrastructure or preparing infrastructure to facilitate those checks. And they could be relatively light touch checks where you have environmental or port health officers inspecting things like timber or other products that are coming in. But that is all at a cost and an extra activity that we haven't had to deal with. And that requires resource not only from the port operator, but local authorities quite often in terms of environmental officers, and also, of course, costs on those traders. So making sure that Scottish trade remains viable is essential. Another positive about Scotland is that Scotland is very much an export-led economy, unlike the rest of the UK, where it is heavily import balanced, etc. And those commodities that we export in Scotland, things like whiskey and fish, I think Brian mentioned aquaculture and fish is I think has been or possibly still is the number one UK export by value, and a big bulk of that is Scottish fish and seafood products. Those products, the changes, because we import, we export much more than we import on those projects. We've already had those changes come in this year, and notwithstanding those challenges that Brian articulated, we're not expecting a big dramatic move there. And then just a final anecdotal example, and I concede to Brian's frustrations with getting goods over to Ireland, but there are now, of course, different regimes in place, even on the island of Ireland. With Northern Ireland, although it's a domestic route, of course, they are applying de facto customs rules. And however, the enforcement of those rules is being done slightly differently to the Republic of Ireland. So we have seen the traffic that travels between Great Britain and the island of Ireland actually move up and hemorrhage towards Northern England and Scottish routes from the west coast of England and of course, places like Kenryon, Lochryan, into Belfast and Larne, more so than those services in Wales into the Republic of Ireland, which have really seen a decline in activity. So ironically, we've seen a slight uptick and an increase in activity on the GB Northern Ireland routes, which some of the Scottish ports have done rather well out of.
Okay, thank you. I'll now move on to Colin Beattie to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Convener. One thing I'm trying to get my head around here is we hear a lot about bottlenecks, and I can understand the bottlenecks arising from the Brexit shambles, but other bottlenecks are caused by, I'm told, by containers being in the wrong place as a result of COVID, of people restocking, perhaps overstocking, because the just-in-time concept's a bit wobbly at the moment, so they're taking extra goods to try and cope with that. How much of these bottlenecks are going to resolve themselves when these containers are in the right place and when people are fully stocked again? There must be a point at which this will ease in certain aspects, perhaps not in others, and I'm trying to understand where that easing might come from, and maybe I can ask Richard Ballantyne to come in on that.
Yes, it's been a big topic of focus across the freight industry, as you no doubt would have seen over the last 18 months or so, and particularly with a few peaks. The issue, as we mentioned earlier, is very much a global challenge, and it was just, it's worth going back very briefly for a bit of a history lesson to remind ourselves that as we rely on a lot of goods being manufactured in Asia, where they are produced in a cheaper, more cost-effective way and shipped round to big hubs like Europe and North America, we did see the Chinese economy lock down first. Of course, that affected production, affected their exports to Europe. We then were short on various goods coming in because we weren't locked down, and there was a bit of a kind of a jostle and an increase in demand. And then, of course, the UK government and Scottish government and other parts of the UK closed down our economies into lockdown, which affected the demand for non-essential goods and services. And of course, those in that time, the Chinese economy opened up and you saw a big glut of shipping containers come into the UK, which wasn't needed. And then you saw runs on storage supply spaces. You saw a shortage of space at ports for getting containers through. And that started the problem. Then we had issues in getting those containers that arrived in, getting them emptied and shipped back to at source, if you like, in Asia, where they would be repacked. And this was particularly a problem, I'd say, in continental Europe and North America. And we were suffering a bit, but not quite as much as the rest of those big markets. Gradually, we continued to unlock ourselves, so to speak, and there was even more demand. You know, we've all kind of seen the demand for consumer products from Amazon home delivery type things, furniture, garden furniture, etc. And all those sort of products, those finished products that we wanted to get round from places like Asia, we did see big backlogs and challenges getting a lot of those commodities in, and then they were in storage. And it has just been an ongoing challenge, coupled with some operational challenges at one or two of the big container terminals in Europe, including the port of Felixstowe, which have all boiled up to create a perfect storm alongside things like haulier shortages and one or two other pressures to really hit our sector in a tough way. And now the forecasts are that this congestion, these issues could stabilize or kind of dramatically increase at short notice for another year at least. And we have seen recently this year the Suez Canal blockage exacerbating the problem. So it is quite a sensitive market that's going to take some time to settle, I would say. Now, equally, just a final point. One, I suppose, kind of a positive for Scotland in a way, was that when you get blockages and particular issues at big hub ports in England, like Felixstowe, the market always looks for alternative routes. And of course, other ports are available. And we saw big lines like Maersk and others reroute into different ports and then feed traffic across to smaller container facilities on the east coast of England and indeed Grangemouth. So, you know, there is a resilient freight system here that means that we can keep the country supplied, if not, perhaps causing a few minor delays.
Thank you. Perhaps I can turn to Kieran Fernandez. I don't know if you heard my original question. Is he there?
Yes, he is. Is he? Sorry, my understanding was that he was... there he is, back. Welcome.
Sorry, there's a fire alarm on the building, so
Did you hear the question that I asked initially?
No, I didn't. Sorry.
Let me just briefly say, we hear a lot about the bottlenecks that we're facing, and some of these obviously are caused by Brexit, but there's others that we're told are due to COVID, people restocking, containers in the wrong place, ships in the wrong place, etc., etc. Now, when you think about it, logically, some of these bottlenecks must resolve themselves when people are fully stocked, when the containers are now back into their correct cycle of being exported and so on. What sort of timescale would you say it would take for that to resolve itself? And which specific elements of the bottlenecks would you say are going to resolve themselves?
I think it's a very good question. So first of all, I think it's very important to understand that supply chains are not linear and are not static. They are evolving. In fact, they evolve quite rapidly and in very unusual ways. And one of the issues, and you particularly look at this from a bottleneck perspective, is a lot of modeling that's done, unfortunately, assume linear or fixed supply chain in a very traditional way. A goes to B, B goes to either C or D, and then you sort of end up modeling it and trying to understand. However, the study which we did, we tried to understand in far detail in what would a supply chain look like and what are the features of a supply chain. And one of the first features of a supply chain is that supply chains are network and they evolve constantly, which makes two things challenging. Firstly, is predict the actors that are involved, and secondly, what the outcomes of these networks are. One of the outcome, as you have rightly stated, is the issue about bottlenecks. So what can we do to do this and understand this better is, first thing I would say is we need to understand how supply chains work, the type of networks they are, and how they connect one another. Now, the reason I raise this is very specifically because they are different in different regions. They behave differently in different regions. The different connectivity they have to not just regional policies, but links to knowledge transfer centers, as well as how citizens behave, vary. So there are a number of these things that need to be taken into account. However, as you say, for example, the most obvious example of bottleneck that perhaps everybody's heard was this example you talked about where citizens were going and trying to basically buy, and the classic example was of flour, which is one, but the other one was of loo rolls. Now, if you actually look at what was happening is only 4% of the flour that was sold is sold through shops and supermarkets. The rest of it are actually going directly to bakeries, to restaurants, directly from the flour mills, and they had no problems. So what was the issue here? The issue in this particular supply chain was that they were intermediary innovation hubs or packaging companies that used to take the flour, they used to put it in different packages, they used to add something to it, they used to minus certain from it. And this is where the bottleneck started. So the bottleneck was not as a result of less produce, or there was an issue in the supply chain in terms of delivery. The bottleneck was purely down to how the innovation hubs were unable to cope with that external demand. So to understand a bottleneck type of an issue, what I would argue is you need to do the four players of policymaking, knowledge transfer, business and society in general. I think there are a number of levers from a policymaking that need to be brought into play. And one of which, without taking too much of the committee's time, almost goes against the sort of report I have written. And that is, I think we have taken, and that includes me, a very simplistic view of how supply chains work. So our entire study has been based on a very, very simplistic understanding of supply chains in Scotland. And that is to look at the standard industry classification as a proxy to understand what happens. Now, this is perhaps the fundamental flaw in any supply chain. Now, you know, we have modeled a number of supply chains. And if you start digging into it, the supply chains that we need to understand them from a business model perspective. What is that particular unit adding value to a particular region, rather than looking at it and say, it is an SIC code, whatever it is, and therefore we will behave and treat it in a very different way. And I think here, the policy levers are absolutely crucial. And I feel there's a bit of work needed in policy making to A, recognize the importance of supply chain, secondly, the behaviors of supply chain, and thirdly, how policy at a regional level can pull the appropriate levers for both resident business clusters, but also new business clusters, to make sure that there is resilience built in a supply chain. So I'm slightly giving a long-winded answer to perhaps a question you were looking for, saying it will all work out. But in my view, the reason it perhaps won't work out is because they are not linear. And it's not just items that flow back and forth. It's ideas, it's innovation, it's knowledge, it's information. And even if there's a blockage in any of these, now I won't necessarily make companies here, but if you think about a company where you go online, order something by 12 o'clock and the item is delivered to your house by 4 o'clock on the very same day. Now, in that company, the reason the item comes from a point to a point is not just because of the physical transportation of it. It's because the knowledge and information that flows into it is as fast as how the delivery takes place. So I think in this conversation, generally what has been missed, and I don't mean in this particular committee, is the importance of supply chain. And what I'm arguing in my work and report is supply chain is the essential artery in an economy. And this has to sort of have a place in serious conversation. And that includes the ongoing debates on how COVID should be managed. The entire advisory group in all devolved nations do not have supply chain experts. They're entirely made up of epidemiologists and biology experts. But I think what is needed is how you also connect supply chain. So I don't know if I'm answered exactly what you're looking for there, but what I'm trying to get to is a supply chain is far more complex than a linear end-to-end point where we can optimize a particular element of bottleneck. You can, and that's an easy solution, but that is not going to solve the problem.
Well, thank you. You've certainly given me a different perspective to look at. Can I turn to Robert Windsor on the same question?
Yeah.
find it a fascinating sector to work in, probably the most fascinating. I think you've got to go back almost to 2008 to start understanding this, for the very simple reason the financial crash then completely disrupted the market. And to be honest, it's never quite recovered from then. That's my personal view. And we've seen a period of market consolidation with shipping lines merging and alliances being formed. And this has, in fact, created an increasingly brittle supply chain. There's a lack of flexibility. Capacity is carefully managed, but there is a finite capacity in the market. And in a way, what's happened in the last 2 years has stretched it. The other problem we have is, as the professor was alluding to, we have got multiple parties within the supply chain, and all of us have slightly different needs. For instance, the shipping lines have gone and built these ultra-large container vessels, which are up to 24,000 TEU now. And that doesn't quite gel with how the port operators function, because you've obviously got to develop the port infrastructure. It then creates a huge problem, if you like, for both the freight forwarders, the transport operators, even customs, you know, the revenue and customs, because you suddenly get this tremendous peak of activity when one of these vessels comes in, because instead of 3 or 4 7,000 to 8,000 TEU vessels, you now get one. And it creates in effect its own bottleneck. And we have seen real issues with that sort of problem. When is it going to solve? Every industry expert I've read about seems to think it would be between 18 and about 30 months' time. You know, obviously demand will come out of the system slightly. The shipping lines are ordering large amounts of new vessels. And they should start feeding into the market from about quarter four of next year. We will hopefully also see a diminution of the impact of EU exit, because you have to remember, forwarders, some of us are looking all the time at Brexit, some of us are looking at the maritime situation, some of us are looking both ways, and it's very difficult to compromise. Just to give you an idea of the situation, on the 17th of October, there were over 600 container vessels looking for a berth. Sorry, not container, they were all types of vessels looking for their berth. Okay. 100 of them plus were off California. About 40 of them were off Europe, of which only 7 were waiting off the UK. And over 300 were looking at somewhere in Asia. So it's going to be predominantly China, Singapore, Hong Kong. That is sucking capacity out of the market. And it's reckoned possibly 12% of the market is actually just waiting around doing nothing. So you can imagine that's the problem. I do think we have a long-term strategic problem in the United Kingdom. We are increasingly becoming an import destination, and increasingly we have less and less exports for shipping lines to load back onto their vessels. In effect, we're becoming a dead end. So now there's an imbalance. Instead of being able to reload some of the containers with export freight, there's less and less of that going out. And that is creating a problem. And it's something I know the shipping lines are concerned with. At the moment, if you look at the photographs in and around the Felixstowe area, you will see vast amounts of old airfields and that sort of thing, full of empty containers waiting for their vessels to go, you know, to take them away. There is no simple solution. It will eventually work itself out, but it's going to be a while.
Thank you.
I'm afraid we'll have to make some progress. I understand it's been a disjointed morning, but if I could ask the final questions and answers to be succinct, that would be helpful. Alexander Burnett, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, convener. Two hopefully quick questions. The first one is, and I'll ask them together now. The first one to Richard Valentine is really, how can free ports improve the resilience of Scotland's supply infrastructure? And does he have any views on how many and the location of them, Scotland's maximum benefit? And my second question is to Professor Fernandes. You know, a very interesting submission. I concur with everything he said. And so, it talks about how they're evolving and unusual supply chains. But without being cheeky, he just suggests more research is needed, which might sound like an answer. This is a relatively short. This is a short study by the committee. To make suggestions and to the Scottish Parliament and to the government. I just wonder if Professor Fernandes is able to suggest any actual solutions and specific policies for the immediate benefit of the supply chain. Thank you. So to Richard Ballantyne first.
Well, thank you for that question. Yeah, free ports is definitely something the sector is particularly interested in. And the advent of the free ports policy has broadly been welcomed as a useful tool and concept. It's more than the traditional free port, which was about easing customs and tariff regimes. This is the UK model, the UK government's model, of which we have 8 locations, spans into things like enterprise stimulus, planning rules, and employment taxes, as well as those customs functions and easements. It's free ports is not a solution directly for a lot of the new bureaucratic controls that Robert very well articulated are coming in as a result of the UK's departure from the single market and the customs union, although there will be some assistance provided if needed for certain operations. It's more an economic development strategy, this free ports proposal, and it's a way of making a business and regulatory friendly environment to attract inward investors, developers, manufacturers, etc., to come into the UK and in Scotland and locate their activities close to a port and possibly take advantage of transshipment opportunities, but also take advantage of fast track planning rules and other taxation incentives, lower business rates, etc., lower national insurance contributions on certain staff. And if you package that all up, it does become quite a good and attractive offer, I have to say. Now, in England, we've got 8, of course, so we were somewhat underwhelmed with the aspiration that there should only be 8. We didn't see the need to cap the number of ports, and that has to be said is the same as our position in Scotland. The Scottish Ports Group, of which we run, which includes all the main Scottish port operators and many others, has around sort of 30 or so cargo gateways in Scotland, some of them quite modest, of course, but you could probably create a case for many of those locations that they should be a free port. So the proposal and suggestion that there may be 1 or 2 free ports stemming from the UK government's free ports policy is somewhat underwhelming, I would say. I think we need to be careful of picking winners in a sector that has traditionally been market-led and made its own decisions and based on competition, etc. We are now seeing government intervention coming in by capping the number. So we're pushing for a more inclusive policy. And then finally, the Scottish government's equivalent green ports policy, some of which will be similar, but we are now seeing a bit of divergence and we're not quite sure whether that will go ahead in parallel in partnership with the UK one or whether there'll be separate mechanisms as have been mooted recently. Those proposals, again, we want to see consistency and inclusivity aligned there. So free ports is an exciting complex concept, but I'm not sure directly whether it leads supply chain issues, certainly not immediately anyway.
Thank you very much. And Professor Fernandes, on the any short-term policy suggestions in whilst we're waiting for more research?
Thank you. I mean, you'll be delighted, and I'm not probably asking for more research to be done. However, what I think is needed in the short term is I think there's got to be a willingness, particularly from policymakers, to start looking at this particular idea from a different framework. And what I mean by this is, perhaps more than me, you have seen loads of reports from predominantly a very economic perspective. So the report would probably give you a cluster of companies, say this particular type of sector is doing better than the other sector and so on and so forth. And this is predominantly driven from the old way of looking at standard industry classification. Now that has a purpose if you want to know how the taxation is working and so on and so forth. But if we are serious about trying to understand that we want to develop an ecosystem, let's say in Scotland, which supports a particular type of industry that exists, or perhaps wants to attract new types of industry that don't exist but are complementary, I think we need to look at a way which is looking at the business models of what can and cannot operate. Now, just to give an example of what I'm trying to say here is, if you look at in the SIC world and call companies that are in the business of pharmaceutical or drug manufacturers, and you would assume that the 2,000 odd companies that operate in the UK and some of very well-known ones in Scotland, that they would all be under one or two standard industry classification code. And perhaps somebody would download a lot of data and present to you and say, this is policies that could work because of the data. Now there are, if you look at the 2,000 odd companies, actually something in the order of 25 to 30 SIC code would be needed to capture that data set. Now, if you then, how can we look at these sectors and therefore build supply chains to support them, both from a policy perspective, but also from a business perspective? Now, if you look at the pharma sector or the drug manufacturing sector, and past example in the news all the time, which I won't mention, but happens to be in Livingston. Now, this is an example of what is called as a business model of commercial strategic alliance. And this would mean financial outsourcing, things like joint marketing and selling, the whole ability of the two partners to produce, technology sharing, et cetera, would be the characteristics of this type of business model, which would manifest itself in Livingston as an example. However, a very close business model to this type of drug manufacturing would be something like personalized stratified medicine or strategic alliance, or going on to VC funded companies, to in-house researching, entrepreneurs, spin out, primary care pharmaceutical, or companies that are in the business of purely buying and selling IP acquisition, biosimilar manufacturing. These are all manifestations of different business model in the so-called SIC code drug manufacturing. I think we need to look at that level of conversation and then ask the question from a policy perspective and business perspective. If we want to suppose in-house researching, and I just use that as an example, as one of the value addition drug manufacturing hubs in Scotland, what do we need? Now, we know what we need. For example, if you want an in-house researching cluster of companies that genuinely is world-class, the sort of things you need is you need to support those companies on how the IP can be protected. You need those companies to have an ability to manufacture, outsource the manufacturing, because they are not manufacturing companies. So you need to make that sure. You need to make sure that there is a B2B connectivity that links into key factors of royalty and patents. You also need many such things. Now, those are where the policy levers come in place. And what I'm trying to say here is, the policy levers for different type of these business hubs or these business model hubs are different. So what is needed? What is needed is for policymakers to say, listen, thanks for the SIC data. How else can we look at the same sectors, and how can we then come up with intervention and support policies? And I would very strongly argue they would look very different to a generic idea of saying, we want to have game manufacturing in, for example, Dundee region, or game development. Now, in game development, you have about 22 different business models that exist. And I don't need to tell you how successful the entire area of gamification is and continuing to grow. But you can't have one universal policy that supports that. So we need to slightly stop looking at SIC code. They have a purpose, but I think we have been reliant on it for too long. And I have been too, as a researcher, because it's easy. The data is already there. All you need to do is download the data, put it into a simple business informatic graphs, and you can make some general assumption. So my response to you is, do we need more research? No. What we do need is a different way of looking at it. I think there are enough models developed that you could use without having to redo the whole thing all over again.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. That's all convenient. Thank you.
Thank you. I will now move on to Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, and hello to the panel. Thank you for putting up with some of the glitches we've had this morning. I want to explore a little bit about how ready we are and what we need to do to meet our ambitious net zero targets and other climate change ambitions that we have, and particularly around what is needed to take advantage of some of the innovations and new technologies that we're going to have to adopt in how we changing what we do, changing how we function both economically and socially. We heard a little bit from Maggie earlier regarding some of the infrastructure requirements in rail, and so also there's been discussion around modal shifts that are possible. But can I ask, in terms of infrastructure or other elements of development, other elements of investment and change, what do we need or what do you need to ensure that we can actually take advantage of the innovations and new technologies that we're going to have to rely on in the future? And if I can ask Brian first.
Hi. Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm based up in Shetland, and at the moment, we're standing at, trying to seem too weird about the situation, really like a kind of generational shift in the kind of the fuels that we're doing. We're actively engaged up here in trying to work with hydrogen with the Orion project up at Sullivan, the repurposing of that terminal from oil and gas to this, you know, which can also provide a route to market for hopefully hydrogen is the best bet at the moment, you know, and some kind of ammonia solution that can help decarbonize shipping. We're in the process of a huge construction boom in terms of a wind farm that's getting built, and doing a lot of experimental work with tidal energy. And there's a transmission link being built between Shetland and down the north to Caithness and Knoss Head, I believe it is. And that's going to allow us to export energy crucially. There's talk in the future of laying a cable basically out to Norway, so we can then be one kind of big thrumming grid. What that will allow us to do here is we can, we'll have a glut of hopefully cheap renewable energy that we can do to decarbonize certainly to the local transport inside Shetland. You know, it can be electric vehicles, and we're making moves with Volvo at the moment. DFDS just placed an order for 100 Arctic units. I think it's the biggest order yet, you know, that are purely electric, and we're looking to get smaller, like 18 tonners, 7.5 tonners, all these things, all the smaller things that do the collections and deliveries and everything from your kind of central hubs, like a kind of spoke and hub model. Okay. So that is what we're looking to do in the immediate future, in like 2023, 2024. We're hit with supply chain issues that a lot of these things are just not available yet, you know, that we can't keep up with the demand of production. So when will these things be here? It's probably going to be the end of next year by the time we start seeing some of these trucks in operation. We're also looking to get, for example, a lot of the stuff, as I mentioned earlier, is temperature controlled, you know, so we're temperature controlled reefer trailers. We're looking at reefer containers that we can use for multimodal logistics to take advantage of rail freight and also shipping. You know, can we instead of putting these things on trucks and trunking them 700 miles, can we ship them? The difficulty with that is the infrastructure is not ready yet, you know, in terms of rail and everything like that. Like I mentioned earlier, for example, to get to basically Glasgow down to Tilbury, it's going to be a day and a half, and it can't be that long. It's just economically won't work. So it's not ready yet. And also the handling facilities, we have reefer trailers, you know, we don't have lots of skeleton trailers and lots of reefers, you know, they're more on the continent they can access, but still. But we are looking to invest in something called sun swap trailers, which are where instead of running like diesel to power the reefer container, the trailers, we're looking to use solar power for that. So we're investing in that now too. So these means we're looking to try and get that done and spread it around. But yeah, it's about how we can do this and take advantage of the wider framework that we're living in, you know, like what we're going to do with this renewable things, how can we support it, and what's the barriers to that. Yeah, no, that's kind of the environmental thing. I would like to say as well, up in Shetland, just without monopolising the time much more, we are kind of ruled by the ferry that takes everything to and from here, as all the Northern Isles are. And that's a bit of a kind of bottleneck to the supply chains, both in Orkney and Shetland, I think.
Yeah. Thanks very much, Brian. Can I go to Richard next? The same question.
Yes, thank you for that. Obviously, very important topic, and actually I'm glad you've raised this, because we do have some asks, as you would you might not expect. Essentially, I think it's important to factor in that freight is quite a sensitive and long-term industry with, you know, self-financing, as I said earlier. And so, unlike other forms of transport, public passenger transport, you know, rail, etc., some areas of aviation, indeed, we don't get that support from government, and we have to do it ourselves. And when you get good aspirations from governments to reach net zero by 2045 or even sooner, etc., the industry, which is built on a sort of long-term commercial structure, has to adjust. So what I'm talking about here is, in my case, ports acquire things like cranes and plants and machinery and warehouses, and they're typically built with a longer term life than you might expect elsewhere. And they have to usually bought on finance and have to pay back the investment. And so when you have cranes that are traditionally, for example, powered by diesel, you know, phasing and moving those over to electric source can be quite costly, although it is happening, I have to say. We're doing our best. But there may be a case for some public support, for transitional support. And that is the case particularly for things like shore power. And this is the, you're probably familiar with this. This is the concept of where a vessel comes into a port, and instead of continuing to generate or have its generators on and its engines on, you may be able to plug it into a local domestic energy source at the port, which is electric, and you wouldn't have all the fumes being pumped out by the ships whilst they're in ports, sometimes in sort of urban areas, etc. Now, the challenge, of course, is not only the cost of that infrastructure, which we think there is a case for some kind of public support there across the board, but the big challenge is actually providing the energy and the electricity. Now, in places like the Northern Isles and Orkneys particularly, you have an abundance of renewable energy that's generated, but elsewhere, we don't have that capacity, we don't have that grid capacity. So there is quite a lot to be done for the maritime community and sector before we can reach a lot of these targets, and a lot to be done by other players, other parties, which I think is a bit of a challenging thing, and it could be quite costly. I think we need to kind of understand that. And then there was a bit of a kind of jokey example, but one of the Norwegian ports a few years ago was testing its own energy supply, shore power supplies, plugged a relatively modest sized vessel into its electricity supply, and it drew all the electricity, and there was a power outage in a small town in Western Norway. So, you know, those examples of how much energy we need to produce, I think is quite a good one. And equally, obviously, that electricity will need to be generated in a clean way itself. So it's no good, you know, generating electricity elsewhere and then just, you know, moving the issue downstream to a port in our case. So yes, it is a challenge. There's a lot going on. I mean, modal shift is something we talked about earlier, and absolutely there's opportunities to get more goods away from roads and indeed off rails even onto coastal ship. But it has to be said that that's quite a niche and specialist sector. We have modal and revenue support grants from the Scottish Government and the UK Government, which can help facilitate this. They're not always taken up. Perhaps we need to look at how those grants regimes are a bit more generous and broader and have a longer life in the maritime, because typically those grants can only be allocated for 3-year basis and just stimulate a new activity, unlike rail where they're much more open-ended. But equally, we have other commercial operations that are already functioning just fine without any government support. So we need to preserve that sort of market. It's a very sensitive one, different one. But I think there's definitely a case for a sort of freight review, looking at how we move towards net zero.
Thanks very much, Richard. And if I could ask Robert the same question.
Our members are waking up to this issue, to be honest. But you have to remember, most of my members are sub-20 employee companies. And there's a variety of factors at play. And I think the first one I would draw people's attention to is quite simply that there are factors outside the UK which influence what happens. Shippers determine routing of cargo very often, and whether it's on air or sea or road, so that has an influence. Most of the bigger members work on a pan-European basis, and they have definitely woken up to this as an issue. But they tend to take their lead from their European headquarters. They've got large departments, and actually, people like DHL and DSV and Schenker employ, specialists in this area, but that's not available to the smaller member. The question I keep being asked by smaller members is, what are we actually trying to change? And there is a feeling that policymakers haven't made it very clear. And certainly there's a view that carbon, we're all obsessed with, but maybe there's other problems as well. Smaller people are looking at this, definitely, the smaller companies, but there's a big concern that the technology is just not there. Yes, vans up to 3.5 tons can probably run on battery or whatever fairly easily. Not so possible for a 40-foot articulated lorry. So the thing is, they are starting to look at it. They're beginning to wake up the question, but it's a very complex area, to be honest. It's actually probably the most complex area I've come across in my career in making this change. It's got to happen, but it's going to be bumpy and messy, I fear. I mean, there's certainly a big problem with infrastructure, particularly for charging, and we hear that all the time. And historically, our sector is a very low profit margin industry. Net profit up 2%, maybe 3% for a lot. So there isn't a lot of fat left over to risk money on either infrastructure or equipment, which may be not what we're going to go. And to be honest, we keep on hearing changes in what I would regard as policy. Firstly, we're going to have, a prohibition of diesel cars on such date, and then it changes, and we've got the same for lorries. And if you look at the arguments in the International Maritime Organization, they are extremely complex, very contradictory, and we just don't know what's happening.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. We are extremely pushed for time. I'm going to allow a brief question from Jamie Halker-Johnson and then a brief question from Michelle Thompson. If the question could be directed to one panellist, that would be helpful.
Thanks very much indeed, Convener. The question is to Brian Hepburn. I've visited Shetland Transport and I've seen some of the great work that they're doing up there, and also to some extent aware of some of the issues. And you touched, Brian, on the issues around ferries. And of course, we've talked about ferries to the continent, we've talked about rail infrastructure, but even getting to your depot for some of your producers can require one or two internal ferries in Shetland. You've then obviously got to have reliability for the ferries down to Aberdeen and capacity on that. And I know a lot of work's been done by Serco and previously to make sure that working with organisations like yourself. Just wonder if you could give us maybe expand on, I think, what you were looking to expand on in terms of some of those issues around the infrastructure within Scotland, within the islands, and what needs to be done better to improve reliability for ferries and roads and that like.
Thanks very much for the opportunity there, Jimmy, to bring that up. We are head up here in Shetland and in Orkney. We're kind of buoyant economies, and we're archipelagos islands. So, for example, for salmon, we produce a lot of salmon here and ship it out. And that gets produced up in the Northern Isles, a great employer up there, you know, and it's good sustainable food, and it's got a high value, well sought after. One of the problems that we've got is we have to catch an inter-island ferry down to the main island of Shetland, for example, and then another, obviously the Northlink Serco ferry down, which is government operated ultimately, down to Aberdeen. And we're we suffer, it's a real bottleneck, it's really constrained, you know, certainly during like livestock season, these kind of things. But a couple of things would improve it. One would be fixed links to some of these smaller islands, you know, like say, for example, tunnels to the island of Yell, and that would start to make it more an attractive place to live, you know, and stave off the threat of depopulation of these remote islands. The second would be bigger or more reliable freight vessels. Like we're experiencing a construction boom here just now, and there's going to be a decommissioning boom. It's great to be so busy, but it comes at a kind of cost. We can't get the stuff here, you know, so there's a cost to opportunity as well that's kind of missed, I think. And this is with offshore developments and wind as well. We need to physically get the equipment here and improve that. If we could ask anything, you know, I'm here to ask anything, it would be kind of just to see if we could put additional tonnage in place to address like the current shortfalls and what we could do to hustle up replacement ferry services. That's really what I was kind of thinking. We struggle. We could be busier, you know, and it's kind of hindering us, I think, both in Orkney and in Shetland. And that's something we could do something about right now, you know, I think, you know, in the short term.
Great. Thanks for that, Brian.
Help answer the question, Tom.
Yeah. It does, and I'll maybe look to follow that up further with you as well. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Michelle Thompson.
Very briefly, we've had a very interesting session where we've covered dynamism in supply chains. We've explored a lot of near-side issues. My simple question to Richard Ballantyne and the other contributors may want to follow up is, have we gained a good understanding of the structural issues and what we need to do to get resilience going forward? So you could answer it yes or no. If the answer is no, please do follow up with some further information because I'm quite aware of time. Thank you, Richard.
I think yes, very shortly, yes. I think we have got a good understanding of resilience issues. It's just you have to factor in the fact that the freight and shipping and ports markets are independent of government. So there is an element of control that policymakers don't have that they might have in certain other sectors. So it's one we could discuss quite in quite a lot of detail, I have to say, but in the interest of time, I'll cut that one off.
Okay, thank you very much for the response. As I said earlier, if witnesses have additional evidence they would like to present to us, I'd be happy to receive written evidence. But I would like to thank all the panellists very much for taking the time this morning and for your patience with our technical issues. And thank you for your contribution and your expertise. I'll now move on to agenda item 3, which is consideration of an SSI. The committee is invited to note the Public Procurement Agreement on Government Procurement Thresholds, etc., Amendment Scotland Regulations 2021. Members will note that in its report, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee drew the instrument to the attention of the Parliament because two errors were identified. The Scottish Government has acknowledged these errors and has laid an amending instrument. At this point, we are asked to simply note the instrument. Are you content? Well, thank you. We'll now move into private session.